physics, motion means a continuous change in the position of a body relative to a reference point, as measured by a particular observer in a particular frame of reference. Until the end of the 19th century, Newton's laws of motion, which he posited as axioms or postulates in his famous Principia, were the basis of what has since become known as classical physics. Calculations of trajectories and forces of bodies in motion based on Newtonian or classical physics were very successful until physicists began to be able to measure and observe very fast physical phenomena. At very high speeds, the equations of classical physics were not able to calculate accurate values. To address these problems, the ideas of Henri Poincaré and Albert Einstein concerning the fundamental phenomenon of motion were adopted in lieu of Newton's. Whereas Newton's laws of motion assumed absolute values of space and time in the equations of motion, the model of Einstein and Poincaré, now called the special theory of relativity, assumed values for these concepts with arbitrary zero points. Because, for example, the special relativity equations yielded accurate results at high speeds and Newton's did not. The special relativity model is now accepted as explaining bodies in motion, when we ignore gravity. However, as a practical matter, Newton's equations are much easier to work with than those of special relativity and therefore are more often used in applied physics and engineering. In the Newtonian model, because motion is defined as the proportion of space to time, these concepts are prior to motion, just as the concept of motion itself is prior to force. In other words, the properties of space and time determine the nature of motion and the properties of motion, in turn, determine the nature of force. In the special relativistic model, motion can be thought of as something like an angle between a space direction and a time direction. In special relativity and Euclidean space, only relative motion can be measured, and absolute motion is meaningless. So comment, what do you think, which model is best for describing motion? An object is in motion when its distance from another object is changing. Whether the object is moving or not depends on your point of view. For example, a woman riding in a bus is not moving in relation to the seat she is sitting on, but she is moving in relation to the buildings the bus passes. A reference point is a place or object used for comparison to determine if something is in motion. An object is in motion if it changes position relative to a reference point. You assume that the reference point is stationary, or not moving. Let's give some love to one of the greatest scientists ever lived and described Newton's laws of motion. Sir Isaac Newton's three laws of motion describe the motion of massive bodies and how they interact. While Newton's laws may seem obvious to us today, more than three centuries ago they were considered revolutionary. In formulating his three laws, Newton simplified his treatment of massive bodies by considering them to be mathematical points with no size or rotation. This allowed him to ignore factors such as friction, air resistance, temperature, material properties, etc., and concentrate on phenomena that can be described solely in terms of mass, length and time. Consequently, the three laws cannot be used to describe precisely the behavior of large rigid or deformable objects, however, in many cases they provide suitably accurate approximations. Newton's laws pertain to the motion of massive bodies in an inertial reference frame, sometimes called the Newtonian reference frame, although Newton himself never described such a reference frame. An inertial reference frame can be described as a three-dimensional coordinate system that is either stationary or in uniform linear motion, that is, it is not accelerating or rotating. He found that motion within such an inertial reference frame could be described by three simple laws. The first law of motion states, a body at rest will remain at rest, and a body in motion will remain in motion unless it is acted upon by an external force. This simply means that things cannot start, stop, or change direction all by themselves. It takes some force acting on them from the outside to cause such a change. This property of massive bodies to resist changes in their state of motion is sometimes called inertia. The second law of motion describes what happens to a massive body when it is acted upon by an external force. It states, the force acting on an object is equal to the mass of that object times its acceleration. This is written in mathematical form as F equals ma, where F is force, M is mass, and A is acceleration. The bold letters indicate that force and acceleration are vector quantities, which means they have both magnitude and direction. The force can be a single force, or it can be the vector sum of more than one force, which is the net force after all the forces are combined. When a constant force acts on a massive body, it causes it to accelerate, that is, to change its velocity, at a constant rate. In the simplest case, a force applied to an object at rest causes it to accelerate in the direction of the force. However, if the object is already in motion, or if this situation is viewed from a moving reference frame, that body might appear to speed up, slow down, or change direction depending on the direction of the force and the directions that the object and reference frame are moving relative to each other. The third law of motion states, for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. This law describes what happens to a body when it exerts a force on another body. Forces always occur in pairs, so when one body pushes against another, the second body pushes back just as hard. For example, when you push a cart, the cart pushes back against you. When you pull on a rope, the rope pulls back against you. When gravity pulls you down against the ground pushes up against your feet, and when a rocket ignites its fuel behind it, the expanding exhaust gas pushes on the rocket causing it to accelerate. If one object is much, much more massive than the other, particularly in the case of the first object being anchored to the Earth, virtually all of the acceleration is imparted to the second object, and the acceleration of the first object can be safely ignored. For instance, if you were to throw a baseball to the west, you would not have to consider that you actually caused the rotation of the Earth to speed up ever so slightly while the ball was in the air. However, if you were standing on roller skates, and you threw a bowling ball forward, you would start moving backward at a noticeable speed. The three laws have been verified by countless experiments over the past three centuries, and they are still being widely used to this day to describe the kinds of objects and speeds that we encounter in everyday life. They form the foundation of what is now known as classical mechanics, which is the study of massive objects that are larger than the very small scales addressed by quantum mechanics and that are moving slower than the very high speeds addressed by relativistic mechanics. If you want to learn more about motion, stay with us. Subscribe to see how many types of motion exist, and way more about future development of the subject. There are lots of questions left, so don't space out. Our next expedition will be even more interesting. If you are still here, grab your knowledge and get out of my train.